Okay, so this is supposed to be the programming session of this multi-core day. And I guess they put me here because I'm typically a programming language guy. But today I'm not going to talk about programming language, but I'm going to talk about testing mostly. So I don't have any good message for programming language design today. I only have message for how to do and why it's important to do systematic concurrency testing to detect concurrency errors. So before we go into systematic concurrency testing, let's start with two known facts. Oops, oh, sorry, this is my outline. Talk about concurrency errors and their sources, systematic concurrency testing, some techniques to fight combinatorial explosion, the tools we have built, some experience and concluding remarks, and I hope I have enough time to actually cover all of them. But let's start with two known facts. Any non-trivial software system out there contains at least one bug. And any reliable software system contains no known bugs. Okay, so what can we infer from these two facts? Is there something that we can infer from these two facts? Any non-trivial reliable software system contains at least one unknown bug. So bugs are there. Okay, in big software systems, bugs are there. You just don't know about them. And notice that this slide doesn't say anything about concurrency. Okay, this is applicable to even sequential programming. When you enter concurrency, you enter a much more harder territory to program and reason about, because concurrent execution is, even for experts, very difficult to reason about. You need somebody like Peter to squeeze his mind, and even he, I think, sometimes he cannot really figure out what's going on, let alone most programmers out there. So there are rare process interleavings that result in bugs that are hard to anticipate, they are difficult to find, they are difficult to reproduce, even if you know that you have a bug. If you try to debug them, they might disappear. They are so-called hidden bugs due to that reason. If you try to look at them, they just don't aren't there anymore. Even if you have fixed some of these bugs, it's hard to know that actually you have really fixed them. And this is a big productivity problem. Okay, programmers spend a lot of time debugging their software, and of course, it can have also severe consequences. So it's an important problem. So one way of dealing with this is to employ something called systematic concurrency testing, or another name for it is called stateless model checking, although I don't think it's a very good name, but this is one of the names that have been used out there. I prefer the systematic concurrency testing. So this is a technique to find concurrency errors, or if you take it to the extreme, to verify their absence. But it's mainly a testing technique. It finds errors more often than you verify that they don't exist. And you try to do that by exploring all possible ways for concurrent execution can influence a program's outcome. So you can think of it as exploring all the possible ways that there are out there for a program to be executed. Now, the nice thing about this is that it's fully automatic. It's a press-button technology. And it also has low memory requirements, and that's actually, I guess, why they chose this stateless word, so that they differentiate from other model-checking techniques that are stateful, or they keep the state around and they have a lot of memory requirements. Now, one bad consequence of this is that it's only applicable to programs with finite executions, which you can think of that you typically programmers don't write tests that are executing forever. I mean, when you write a test, you want your test to terminate and tell you a result so that you can check that it's happening. So this is only applicable to finite executions, so far at least. Now, the things that attacks are the different sources of non-determinism that are out there in programs. And the most important one for this talk is the scheduling non-determinism. The determinism that you have by how different threads can interleave and how they can interact with each other. So processes can race to access shared resources. They can be preempted by the scheduler, either be it an operating system scheduler or even a scheduler of a VM. They can be preempted at arbitrary points. So you have to think about these possibilities that exist. Also, there might be timing non-determinism. Sleeping processes can wake up at any point. Timers can fire at arbitrary points. So you have to take these things into account in some way. And then on top of that, when concurrency enters the picture, you have memory model effects. And we heard about these things in other talks, so I will not talk too much about this right now. But you also have to handle this, especially in some low-level languages like C or effectively everything that gets compiled to assembly. And then, of course, you have one more source of non-determinism in programs, the input or data non-determinism. And for that, to use a systematic concurrency testing tool right now, at least the ones that we provide, you have to deal with that yourself. So it doesn't, none of the tools looks at input non-determinism or data non-determinism. So you have to design your test and check for all possible ways that you can use the programs. And the technique doesn't really work when you have non-deterministic calls, when you call random. So all the threads have to execute in a deterministic fashion on their own. So with that said, let's try to see how we can combat the scheduling non-determinism. And it's a slide here that I've borrowed from a presentation on the tool Chess, but I could have done this myself. It's not so deep. Let's say that we have just two threads and two shared variables, X and Y. And the programs that they execute are very, very short. So let's say that the green thread, we start with 0, 0 for X and Y. Let's say that the green thread goes first and executes both its steps, and then the red thread executes its steps. So the end result is that the values of X and Y are 2 and 2. But this is not the only thing that can happen, so we get this trace effectively here. So then we need a way of exploring other traces that might exist, other executions that might exist. So we start flipping if we want to exhaustively check all possible things that can happen. We start flipping here instructions, and then we explore this trace. And there is one more where the green thread goes first, which is this one. And then there are all the other six, there are all the other three possible ways, so six in total. But if you notice carefully here what's happening, you have six, even for these two small programs, you have six possible ways that these things can be interleaved, or all the different traces, but you only have four different outcomes. And ideally, you would like to actually have a method that only checks these four different outcomes, as opposed to the six ways that these two programs can be interleaved. Okay, so you need something to combat the combinatorial explosion. And it actually gets worse. Even if you have an even simpler program here, you have n variables, and there are n threads, and each of them is accessing its own variable, so to say, although they are really shared, these ones. If you try to enumerate here all the possible interleavings, you will soon realize that this is exponential. If you do it naively, this is exponential in the number of threads that you have. But really, the outcome here is just one. So ideally, you would like to have something that allows you to explore even this case with just one interleaving, with one trace. Try to figure out that this is actually the only possible outcome that you will have. Now, so for some of you, this is known stuff. I hope that not to all of you, this is known stuff. But there are techniques out there developed long ago called partial order reduction techniques that allow to explore just a subset of all these interleavings and still cover all these behaviors. So if you do that sort of thing and you want to employ a partial order reduction technique, you need a way to find out dependencies between these instructions that get executed. Now, if you do this sort of thing statically, you need a very powerful technique that can figure out that all these accesses are actually to different memory locations. So doing static partial order reduction will not take you very, very far. So that's where, I should have explained this thing. So if we just look at just two threads and we do what I did before, these two things, we can soon figure out that the order of independent events does not matter. And that's where partial order reduction comes to play. And allows us to eliminate one of the two possible interleavings and end up with only one. And if I had more time, I would be showing you the same thing with n threads rather than two, but you would see that actually it would be exactly the same here. You will end up with just one because all these things are independent. As I was saying, if you want to find out that these things are independent by doing a static partial order reduction, you need a very powerful analysis that will tell you that you are only accessing different memory locations statically at compile time. So most people don't do that sort of thing, or there are techniques that don't do this sort of thing at compile time, but they do it dynamically while the program is running, where you have all the information, where you know for sure that these things are accessing different memory addresses. And these are called dynamic partial order reduction techniques. They run the program and they record events that happen and only record the event that affects the shared data as they happen. So you don't pay too much overhead by recording everything. You only record stuff that goes to the shared data. And then after they run a particular execution, then they determine pairs of conflicting events that you have in this trace, and they try to find suitable rescheduling points where they can flip these instructions, as I showed in the first slide, and they can now explore some other interleaving. This is not some stuff that we have done, but we have significantly extended the state of the art in this area. We haven't invented dynamic partial order reduction, but I think we have invented something to very, very good algorithms in that area. One called source DPOR, which is identical to the first algorithm that has been, or to the most well-cited at least algorithm that has been done for dynamic partial order reduction. I will name it as a classic algorithm. And as I'm going to show in the next slides, so even source DPOR has significantly less explored traces and time. So time that it takes to explore these traces. But also we have done an optimal DPOR algorithm, an algorithm for dynamic partial order reduction that completely prevents the exploration of traces that DPOR algorithms will discover as redundant. It only explores one trace per one Mazukiewicz trace and doesn't even start the exploration of traces that the other DPOR algorithm will discover eventually that they are redundant and they will stop the exploration. So it does that sort of thing with a technical construct called wake-up trees, So you need to store a bit more information out there, but in practice, the extra overhead that you have is not bad. So how good is this? So we took the classic paper by Flanagan and Godefroy, published in Popul 05, and we took the two benchmarks that it had there to show that YDPOR is a very good algorithm. So that paper was comparing against other implementations without DPOR and was showing very, very good numbers. So we took those benchmarks. One of them is called file system, and the numbers that you see here is how many threads they get spawned. And their algorithm is the one called classic here, and our work is the two algorithms, the source DPOR and the optimal DPOR. And you can see that there is an exponential difference in the number of traces that get explored, and the time is some seconds here, while it's in the order of some minutes for the classic DPOR algorithm. So we published that thing in Popul 14, almost 9 years after the, or exactly 9 years actually, after their paper. And in the second benchmark that they had, you can see actually that it's the difference is getting even bigger. The source and the optimal algorithm require less than a minute, while the previous one requires almost an hour. We also showed there that you can have an arbitrary difference between them. You can construct benchmarks where it grows, and the difference between them can be exponential. And this stuff, they need some hours, if not, what is it, half a day, this thing, or something. Anyway, so now, okay, so we wrote a Popul paper. So why should you care about this sort of thing? Because the algorithms are generic. They are parametric with respect to the dependency relation, and you can actually apply them to most models of concurrency out there. In particular, you can apply them to Erlang or to the concurrency model that Erlang supports, which is based on message passing and selective received. You can have some shared memory, no matter what you hear from Joe. There is shared memory out there in the Erlang implementation in the form of edge tables. He even said it in his talk. So there are data races, and you have to deal with them. And there is dynamic process creation. But you can also apply it to C and P thread programs where there is shared memory and there are thread blocking constructs like locks. So we have built two tools through a long process. And of course, I don't have enough time to actually tell all the stuff about the two tools. The first one is called Concurrror for concurrency error. And it's a systematic testing tool for Erlang programmers. So this tool, given a program and a test to run, better have some correctness criterion, systematically will explore all the process interleaving, and it will present a detailed interleaving information about all the errors that exist in the execution of these tests, of the test. So the errors that detects are process crashes and abnormal termination. You can annotate your program with some assertions at various places, and it will detect that these assertions are violated, and can also detect deadlocks, i.e. Lack of progress for processes, for Erlang processes. It's out there. This is a screenshot of the homepage of the tool, and where you can find tutorials and, of course, the code. and some publications and how to contact us and ask questions and so on. So it's a very easy tool to use. It's scalable in the sense that it's applicable to real world programs, not just the one that I will show in the next slide. It's precise. Any error, any concurrency error that it reports is actually possible to occur. It does not introduce new behaviors that don't exist in the language. And it finds all concurrency errors for a particular test by capturing all scheduling non-determinism and exhaustively exploring it by the algorithms. Actually, it has both source DPOR and optimal DPOR implemented, and the default there is the optimal DPOR. So how do you use this? You write your regular module in Erlang or your program. It may have a lot of modules, and the tool knows how to automatically instrument all the libraries that you need and you are using. And you also need to write a test, and the test says your correctness criterion. So my correctness criterion here for this test is that if I call the pong function from the ping pong module, this will always return OK. So you can see that it's very simple to use. You don't have to do something really fancy. And of course, you can put even this test in the same module. And then you run Concurrror by following the tutorial, just typing Concurrror and the name of the test, and it will explore all the possible interleavings. And if there is an error, like in this test, it will give you something like that. It checks 5 interleavings. Actually, the version now checks even less. It has one error, and the error is that an exception is a bad darg exception because you are trying to register something in a name of a process that is dead. I will not go into details and explain this more, but you can see that you can understand these things. It gives you also an explanation of what went wrong. And you can see here that there were 2 processes. The P1, the starting process, spawned a child process, P11. And then it sent a message to the parent. It exited, and then it tried to register the child, which is dead, with this name, and there was a crash. Now, this has been used out there, and Stavros here found me 2 tweets from the use from that mentioned the name Concurrror. And I'm not even in Twitter, so I don't really know. I don't like actually the social medium at all. But I like these 2 tweets for a totally different reason than what you think. It's not that they say good things about Concurrror, but they say things that at least I never imagined that somebody would be using Concurrror for. The first one is actually an Elixir programmer. I haven't even heard of Elixir when I started designing Concurrror. It was supposed to be for Erlang, not for another language called Elixir that just happens to be using the Erlang runtime system. So I like it because it's a program that people in languages that I'd never thought would be targeting are actually using. The second reason, the second tweet, and the reason why I like it is that actually this one was a designer at VMware that was trying to implement a new algorithm, a new distributed algorithm. And it used Concurrror to verify the correctness of his distributed algorithm implementation. He encoded this as an Erlang program and then tried to figure out whether he has missed some cases. And he wrote this tweet when Concurrror came up with a situation where the tool helped him. So even though there is an ouch and a freaking word in these 2 tweets, which typically you wouldn't associate with pleasure, I like these 2 tweets. So the second tool we have built in the group is called Nidhugg, and it's a systematic concurrency testing tool for CNP thread programs. It compiles the program with ErLLVM and then generates and executes traces at the ErLLVM intermediate representation. This tool uses only source DPOR, not the optimal algorithm, but even the source DPOR algorithm is very good. And uses something, a notion called chronological traces that allows you to capture effects that the TSO and the PSO memory model have to your program. And the nice thing about these chronological traces is that they work quite well with the DPOR algorithm. It also has a partial support for power and ARM memory models, but I will not say much about this thing in this talk. So I will actually skip the TSO and PSO and the chronological trace stuff and mention that Nidhugg is available on GitHub, and you can get all its source code and you can try to run it. There is also a tutorial and a user manual, which is actually quite well written. There is no home page for the tool right now, but we will be creating one hopefully soon. Now, in the last 2 or 3 minutes that I have left, or perhaps less than that, I will briefly say something that we have done recently with Nidhugg. We have worked on applying Nidhugg on a real code base as opposed to just Erlang programs. The Linux RCU, the Linux kernel RCU implementation. The RCU is the read copy update mechanism that is heavily used in the Linux kernel to provide scalable concurrency and access with a zero-cost mechanism to in certain situations, or in many situations, actually. And we have modeled RCU, especially its grace period algorithm. We have done much more than that, but I will not cover it in this slide. And we did the actual thing. We modeled RCU, its grace period algorithm, callback handling, the DIN tick idle system. Don't ask me to tell you right now what these things are, but I can definitely talk over coffee break with this for this. And we also injected a lot of bugs. And we injected a lot of bugs that had happened in real systems. In RCU development over the years, and the tool has actually found them all in a few seconds. Very, very fast. And also it found another actual bug from an older kernel that it was fixed by a fluke. And we actually show it to the developer, and we show the scenario where it happened, and he confirmed that actually this is a bug. And for 4 different kernels, we verified the grace period guarantee, both under SC and TSO. And depending on the kernel, the verification takes anywhere from 6.5 seconds for kernel 3.0 to 30 minutes for kernel 4.3, and to something like 18 minutes for the most recent kernel. And that has to do with the fact that these kernels have different underlying implementation for the other components in the kernel. The RCU code has changed, but not so much, but the rest of the kernel has changed. And this with very low memory requirements, so we can actually do that sort of thing in our laptop. That's where I want to stop, sort of, by some concluding remarks. There is a lot of problems with concurrent execution, and you need tools that will give you some confidence that you don't have any concurrency errors. And we believe that systematic concurrency testing is a very promising approach to detect those errors and or verify their absence if you happen to have a situation where you don't have that many interleavings for the DPOR algorithm to explore. We have made effective algorithms and techniques that extend the state of the art in the area, and more importantly, I guess for this audience, tools that you can that incorporate these techniques, and you can download or get in touch with us and help you in employing them in your code base. On that note, there is UPMark support for industrial collaborations, so if you happen to have a code base out there that you think that these tools are something that you would like to give it a try and you don't have the manpower to do so, We are willing to help you, provided that you also will spend some effort in this, not so much effort as we would spend, but that you will work with us to actually be using these tools in your code base. And you can talk to me over the coffee break with that. I would like to stop here, but say that this has been a collaborative effort. I'm the one who presents this stuff. And of course, I have worked a bit in this area, but there are many other people that have also worked and are responsible for some of this work here that I presented. In particular, the two people that are shown here in blue are the people that have done most of the work in the tools. And I think they deserve a big thanks more than I do for this talk. So thank you.
So do we have questions for Kostis?
Yep.
So what roughly would be the effort of porting this to Java or some other language?
Reporting what?
So the question was how would it be possible to move this over to Java, use it in Java?
But what exactly do you?
So the tool now supports Erlang and C.
There are two different tools.
Yeah.
It's not the same tool.
Oh, okay. But
there is one tool called Concurrror and one tool called Nidhugg.
Yeah, but the underlying techniques would be similar.
The underlying techniques, the dynamic partial order reduction algorithm is totally language agnostic. Mm. You just have to define a dependency relation between which things conflict. In the language of case of Erlang, which is a high level language, for example, a sender and a received conflict with each other, or two sends might conflict with each other because you might get the messages in a different order. In the language, in the case of C or assembly, effectively, a read and a write conflicts. You know, so you have to define these things for depending on the level that you want to do it. You want to do it at Java source code. You want to do it at Java bytecode, or else you have to define this dependency, and then you can implement a tool like that.
Okay, so I think we're running out of time and the coffee is getting cold. So let's thank Kostis.